In the last chapter of participle, we knew how to use the participles and what are the different types of participle. Now let us continue the same topic and learn what the uses of the participle are. So now let's move towards the uses of the participle. It will be noticed that the continuous tenses in active voice are formed from the present participle with tenses of the verb be, as we know it well that in the present continuous tense or in any type of continuous tense, we use the ing form, which is the present participle. Okay. For example, when I say I am loving, loving is the present participle which I have used in the present continuous tense. When I say I was loving, again loving is the present participle and I am using it in the sentence of a past tense. And when I say I shall be loving, loving again is the present participle and I am using this present participle in the future continuous tense. One more thing about the participle, that the perfect tenses are formed from the past participle with tenses of the verb have. So when I say I have loved, the verb loved is the past participle which I have used in the present perfect continuous tense, in the present perfect tense. When I say I had loved, again loved is the past participle which I have used in the past perfect tense. And when I say I will have or I shall have loved, again the verb loved is the past participle which I have used in the future perfect tense. Okay, now the passive voice is formed from the past participle with tenses of the verb be. For example, so when I say I am loved, loved is the past participle and I am loved is the passive voice. I was loved is the passive voice of simple past tense and loved is again the past participle. I shall be loved, this is again a passive voice and loved is the past participle. So the past participle is also used in the passive voice as well as in the active voice. Now we have seen that participles qualify nouns or pronouns. They may be used They may be used attributely. As a rolling stone gathers no moss. Here in this sentence, rolling is the present participle, and here the participle has been used attributely. One more sentence. His tattered coat needs mending. Here in this sentence, tattered is the past participle, and this has been used as attributive. One more example. A lost opportunity never returns. Again, the same thing is here. Lost here is the past participle, and this has been used as an attributive. Clear? One more use of the participle is that the participle can be used predicatively also. So when I say the man seems worried, here in this sentence we have a past participle worried, and this has been used predicatively because it has been used in the last in place of a predicate. One more example to prove the same thing is that he kept me waiting. Again, waiting is the present participle, and it has been used as a predicate here in this sentence because it has been used in the last. Another use of participle is that the participle can be used absolutely with a noun or pronoun going before. For instance, when I say the weather being fine, I went out. Here in this sentence, being is the present participle, and it has been used absolutely with a noun or pronoun. One more example to prove the same point. Many having arrived, we were freed from anxiety. Here in this sentence, having is the perfect participle, and this has been used absolutely going before a noun or a pronoun. One more sentence. The sea being smooth, we went for sail. Here in this sentence also, being is the present participle, and it has been used absolutely in this sentence. Now, it will be seen that in each of the above sentences, the participle with the noun or pronoun going before it forms a phrase independent of the rest of the sentence. Such a phrase is called an absolute phrase, and a noun or pronoun so used with the participle is called a nominative absolute. Now, an absolute phrase can be easily changed into a subordinate clause. For example, so when I say spring advancing, the swallows appear. In this sentence, spring advancing is an absolute phrase, and this can easily be changed into a subordinate clause when I say when spring advances. Here, when spring advances is the subordinate clause of time. One more sentence. The sea being smooth, we went for a sail. Here in this sentence, the sea being smooth is an absolute phrase, and this can easily be changed into a subordinate clause when I say because the sea was smooth. This is the clause of reason. Now, many times we make mistakes in using the participles. So, the errors in the use of participles are given below. Some of the common errors that we make while using the participles are that since the participle is a verb adjective, it must be attached to some noun or pronoun. In other words, it must always have a proper subject of reference. The following sentences are incorrect because in each case the participle is left without proper agreement. So when I say standing at the gate a scorpion stung him, now here in this sentence standing at the present participle denotes that a person was standing at the gate, Okay, but it has not been clarified who was standing, because this sentence means that a scorpion was standing at the gate and it stung somebody else. So it creates a confusion, lot of confusion is there. Okay, who is standing at the gate and whom did the scorpion sting? Okay, as it is the sentence, as it is the sentence reads as if the scorpion was standing at the gate. So it should be made clear for whom are we using the participle. Okay, so standing at the gate, he was stung by a scorpion would be the correct sentence. Okay, this is the incorrect sentence. Now the correct sentence will be like this: standing at the gate, he was stung by a scorpion. Now it is all clear that he was standing at the gate and that time he was stung by a scorpion. So here in this sentence we have he as the subject of reference for the participle. One more example to prove the same fact: going up the hill, an old temple was seen. Again, in this sentence, going is the present participle, but it does not have a proper subject of reference, because this sentence reads as going up the hill. It means the temple went up the hill, okay, and then an old temple was seen. So this also creates a confusion. And instead of writing this sentence or saying this sentence, we should say going up the hill we saw an old temple. This is the correct sentence now, because here we is the pronoun and going qualifies the pronoun we, and we is the proper subject of reference. Another example: entering the room, the light was quite dazzling. Entering the room, the light was quite dazzling. Now this sentence reads that the light entered the room and it was quite dazzling, and this is incorrect because it creates a lot of confusion. So in place of saying entering the room the light was quite dazzling, we should say entering the room we were quite dazzled by the light, or entering the room I found the light quite dazzling. Now, uses however permits in certain cases such constructions as the following, where the participle is left without a proper subject of reference. The participle in such cases is called an impersonal absolute. For example, taking everything into consideration, the magistrate was perfectly justified in issuing those orders. In this sentence, taking everything into consideration, the magistrate was perfectly justified in issuing those orders. The present participle is taking, but the magistrate is not the proper subject of reference for the participle taking. Even then, we accept this construction as a correct sentence. Considering his abilities, he should have done better. In this sentence also, considering is the present participle and the subject of reference, he is not appropriate. Because somebody else considered his abilities and so somebody else should advise him to do better in future. So here again the present participle does not have an appropriate subject of reference, even then it is accepted as a correct construction. Okay, now it will be noticed that in the above instances, the unexpressed subject is indefinite. Thus, roughly speaking is like if one speaks roughly. Sometimes, as in the following example, the participle is understood. So when I say, sword in hand, he rushed on the jailer. Here in this sentence, sword in hand, the participle being has been omitted. Okay, so in place of saying sword being in hand, he rushed at the jailer, I can say sword in hand, he rushed at the jailer. So in such examples, the participle can be omitted. One more example. Breakfast having been over, we went out for a walk. Here in this sentence, having been is the perfect participle and we have omitted this and we have said the same sentence in breakfast over we went out for a walk. So we should take care while constructing such sentences. As far as it is possible, we should use the participle and we should also mention the subject of reference in the sentences. Okay, but when it is not possible for us to mention the subject of reference, then we should try to make such sentences in which the subject can be clarified. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you. Now an exercise is being given to you to solve the examples and then see how much have you understood about the topic. Okay. Pick out the participle in each of the following sentences. Tell whether it is a present or a past participle. And also how it is used. The first sentence is, generally speaking, we receive what we deserve. In this sentence, speaking is the present participle, and here in this sentence, adverb modification is there because generally is the adverb and it has modified the verb speaking. Okay. Now, second sentence, having gained truth, keep truth. Third sentence, I saw the storm approaching. Fourth sentence, hearing a noise, I turned round. Fifth sentence, considering the facts, he received scant justice. So these are the four sentences which you have to read and then tell whether it is a present or a past participle and also how it is used. That's all for today. Thank you.